Hello everyone, good evening. Thanks for joining. Welcome to IIT Gandhinagar seminar series or webinar series on social justice. So last year we had organized a number of sessions, and early this year we thought we'll continue, but because of COVID, we were not able to restart the series. And many of them suggested that we should start a monthly series and on the topic of social equality and social justice. But before I begin, I would like to thank Prashant Dingole and Gautam Banerjee for sharing their ideas and suggesting speakers. And this semester, the focus is on media and social justice. We have planned three talks. One is today, one in October, one in November. I'll make some announcement towards the end of the session. Before I introduce our speaker, I just want to make two reference to two reports I came across, which I thought it would be very interesting to set the context. One report in 2006, and the second report in 2019. The 2006 report was prepared by CSDS, and it is published in Media Study Group. So what the survey did is they surveyed 37 national media organizations in Delhi, and they found out that out of 315 key positions held in these national newspapers and media, both in Hindi and English, both print and online, out of 315 key positions held, only 0% was occupied by scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. And the rest, 85% of them were dominant caste, and the rest were distributed across OBC, Christians, Muslims, etc. That is in 2016. Shocking but not surprising. And after 15 years, in 2019, another study by Oxfam India and News Laundry, the report is titled, Who Tells Our Stories Matter? Representation of Marginalized Caste Groups in Indian Newsrooms. And the report begins by a quote by Sudipto Mandal, who is a journalist in Al Jazeera. And this is what the quote says. Sudipto Mandal says, after searching the country for more than 10 years, I have been able to find 8 Dalit journalists in the English media. Only 2 of them have risked coming out. And this is in 2019. Again, not surprising, but still these data are very, very startlingly. It's very important to share this. And the report says that out of 121 newsroom leadership positions, 106 are occupied by dominant caste. Again, 0% by scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. So there are two questions I would like to place it in front of you before I introduce the speaker of the day. So in the absence of Dalit and Adivasi voices, who are representing them and how are they being represented? I think today's topic is also related to that. And can the issues of marginalized communities be included in this highly, what I call the monoculture, non-diverse spaces of media boardrooms? And how can we make this space diverse, democratic, and inclusive? So to help us understand these issues better, I'm very pleased and privileged to welcome Mr. Roxy Gagdekar. And he is the first in the series. And Roxy Bhai is a journalist who is presently working with the BBC Gujarati service. He carries an experience of over 15 years in the field of journalism and has widely reported on the topic of social justice. He has reported on the issues of discrimination against Dalit and tribal communities of the country. In the year 2017, he received the Best Reporters Award by Gujarat Media Club. And before joining BBC Gujarati service, he has worked with Ahmedabad Mirror, Daily DNA English newspaper. But he started his career as a journalist from Gujarat Samachar, which is a very popular vernacular leading newspaper of Gujarat. Roxy is also the founding member of internationally renowned theater group called Bhudan Theater. Many of you might have heard of this group. And the group is very active and is instrumental in raising concerns about denotified tribals of India. He also represented the denotified tribals at the United Nations Forum in US. So thank you so much, Roxy Bhai, for agreeing to join us and give this talk. You have around 30 to 35 minutes. And my request to the audience is that after Roxy Bhai's talk, we will open the floor for Q&A. And I'm specifically told that you should be typing in the Q&A box and not chat box. Is that correct, Hatim?
Yes, ma'am.
type your questions in Q&A box and not in the chat box. And thank you, and over to you, Roxy.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody, for joining. Friends, actually, first of all, let me thank you, everyone, for joining to hear me on this important issue of the representation of Dalits and tribals in today's media. When we say representation, what we mean is, you know, in both the ways, the space that the news of Dalits and tribals get in today's media, as well as the news items, their news items that it has been covered in the media houses, and the journalists, anchors, or people in the news newsroom who works on the news desk, who are from these marginalized sections, whether they are there in these newsrooms or not. So it's who represents and what is been represented about them in the media is been mainly. I'll try to discuss on that. I believe that along with all other industries, I think diversity plays an important role in the media industry as well. Let me start with a small exercise with all of you. Can you just try to remember one or two news items that you have read recently or in recent past? Just give yourself a few seconds. Can you just recall a few news items? No, you don't have to tell me, just recall it. So if that news items that you have read is related to, you know, something to do with the Dalits or the tribals or any other marginalized communities, then I think it's okay. But if it is not, then please try to understand that there is something wrong in the system of delivering the news to the people who are reading it, or people like you and me, or people like, you know, your friends or your family members. So I know most of you are aware about how a newsroom media setup works. But before I come to my main point, I feel that I should tell you about the newsroom setup. First of all, let me tell you, what does a journalist do? A journalist reports about whatever is happening around her. The work of a journalist is to report about the incidents as well as tell the stories around her, or find out the untold stories and communicate it with the rest of the world. For that, some journalists are assigned beats, say for instance, a crime beat or a court beat, where the journalists are imbibed in that circle to report that happenings. These reporters or journalists mostly report about the routine in their beat, the routine things that happens daily. Sometimes they are also required to come up with special stories from their beats. You might be, meeting many journalists in your campus who try to, you know, get more and more stuff from you and from your professors who are assigned the campus reporting. Nowadays, it is normally seen that the flow of special stories has increased in all platforms of media, which includes print media, TV media, and digital media. The reporters report to these reporters. What do? They report to their chief reporters or the input head in a television setup. And they eventually, every one of them, report to the editor in a newsroom setup. So editor, reporter, or chief reporter, or input editor, these are the people who are actually, you know, trying to deliver news to people, to the audience, to people like you, or, you know, people like your family members. The special stories, news, or the news angles that we see in newspapers, TV, or in digital platform are actually the product generated from the minds of these people, the journalists, the chief reporter, the input head, the output head, and the editor. So on a day-to-day basis, it is mainly the journalist, chief reporter, and the output editor, input editor, who sets the day's agenda. What are we going to report today? What are we going to, you know, deliver to the people today? While a long-term coverage plan or a long-term agenda of a media house is set up by the CEO and the owners of the media house. Everything that we see, read, and listen comes to us through these people and their agenda. I'm not here to discuss about the long-term agenda of any media house. That's not my subject. But to give you an idea of the day-to-day coverage of a media house and how does that, how does the marginalized communities either finds their voice or how is their voice being suppressed in these news media? As I mentioned earlier, the day's agenda is set by journalists, her chief reporter, input or output editor, and the editor. Most of the things that we read, see, and hear had actually came from the understanding of these three types of people in every media house. If their understanding lacks the knowledge about the people about whom they are reporting, the socio-political condition of a community or a tribe, the social structure and their relationship with the government or the mainstream society, they knowingly or unknowingly, they fail to see a balanced picture, and eventually what we hear, read or see is a news item that is quoted with an idea of journalism that is highly influenced with the mainstream middle class people. The feeling of the others is very strong in such atmosphere. The reporters are often seen reporting on the things about Dalits and the tribals without, I'm saying this based on my observation and my experience, without bothering to learn more about them. So there are many reporters who will report about, you know, an atrocity case that happens with the Dalit, but they will not be able to understand the socio-political structure in what circumstances that thing has happened. Their knowledge is limited to the case-to-case basis and the government feedings mainly. The idea of the others can clearly be seen in many, many media reports. I believe there is a strong notion of the others that prevail in some newsrooms. A majority of the journalists and almost all the chief reporters or editors in the newsroom are from the middle-class society, and many of them still carries a Brahminical notion of society and the caste system. Please note when I say this, please note that I am not generalizing it, but I am trying to say that majority, maximum, or most of them carries such notion, and there are exceptions to it everywhere. Many of them write or debate on Dalit and tribal issues, but I feel that they lack that empathy that takes away the notion of the others from them. It is more sort of a news than actually digging up and actually, you know, telling the problem of that community or that marginalized segment. Unless one is aware about the socio-political and social structure of a community, it is difficult to write about that community. And that is one of the main reasons why we are not seeing effective, impactful news and news stories on marginalized communities. We see news on marginalized communities, but you know, the problems mainly are very, you know, event-based, very incident-based. You don't see, for example, you don't see regular news items on the marginalized community. Even though a large numbers of OBCs are journalists, and even at higher position, even though there are many Dalit journalists, the percentage is less, but there are some Dalit journalists. The condition of tribals and denotified tribals, which are also known as the ex-criminal tribes, is worse in this scenario. As Ambika mentioned about Oxfam's report, I also want to mention something more about that report. In that report, one can easily spot that the representation of tribal in Indian media is even lesser than the Dalits, which itself is very negligible. So even the tribals are even the marginalized among the marginalized tribals and the denotified tribals. So according to this report, the journalists and their bosses are mainly from the mainstream society. I'll share the link of that report if you guys want to know. So that report says that out of 121 newsroom leadership positions, editor-in-chief, managing editor, executive editor, bureau chief, or the output editor across the newspaper, TV news channels, news websites, magazines, 106 are occupied by upper caste. And there were no tribal, no Dalits at the leadership position. Three out of every four anchors of debates are upper caste. Not one is Dalit, Adivasi, or even OBC. For over 70% of their primetime debate, the TV debate that we see regularly, Over 70% of primetime debate shows, news channels draw the majority of the panelists from the upper caste. No more than 5% of all articles in English newspapers are written by Dalits and Adivasis. Hindi newspapers fare slightly better at around 10%, this report says. Around 70% of byline articles on news websites are written by people from the upper caste. Only 10 of the 972 articles featuring on the cover pages of the 12 magazines that was studied by under this report are about issues related to caste. I would say that the real picture is even worse than what this study indicates. Before joining the BBC, in all the newsrooms that I have worked, I had met very negligible tribal, while I have seen very few Dalit journalists in Gujarat. Almost all the peons and serving staff in these newsrooms are Dalits. However, the ones who managed to get jobs as journalists right now in Gujarat are doing good work. There are very negligible tribal journalists in Gujarat. But the percentage of such people is negligible. So let's come to the point, what problem does it create if you don't have Dalit, tribal or denotified tribal as journalists or not at the leadership position? I would say firstly, it is difficult to understand what is actually happening on the ground and what is the exact news. The news that comes to us, as I said earlier, is quoted with a mainstream society idea. So the exact news doesn't come to us. Take the example of a Vijayanagar firing of 2008 in Gujarat in a tribal area where two tribal were shot dead in a police firing. Entire reporting was based on the police briefings. The violence erupted on the issue of forest land in Gujarat. However, the tribal representation was limited to the quotes and comments of the tribal, but nothing was mentioned and reported about their dependency on the forest as well as on their connection with the forest. The reports on the face of it looks balanced. You know, if you read the report, you see that, okay, there is a tribal representation. Someone is telling something about, you know, tribal's presentation. The report on the face of it looks balanced as it has all the sides, but actually I would say it's a type of tokenism of balancing the report to report the issue of struggle between the tribal and government. There are several other instances where it is easier to spot how the lack of understanding of the lives of marginalized community is actually responsible for biased reports. Take the example of several reports where a crime reporter in any news setup, maybe a TV journalism or newspaper. Now take the example of several reports where a crime reporter does not hesitate to write the name of a tribe or community only because the government briefings mentions that that tribe or that community is criminal. I have collected some reports which says that, you know, Chhara gang nabbed, the Dafers arrested, the Dafers involved in highway robberies. So it has been reported completely on the basis of police briefings. This is same for all language newspaper, I would say. Even the English newspaper also report in the same manner. The journalists so much rely on the government information that sometimes they become a part of government's, you know, briefings, and they fail to balance it with the exact things that happens with these communities. So who are these people who give such headlines that builds a complete different image of that community? I myself belong to one such community. That's why my community has been facing such issues on regular basis. So that's why I know that this is a very serious problem when someone writes that, you know, Chhara gang arrested. So if someone writes that Chhara gang is arrested, then the Charas who are doing job, they face a lot of problems in their jobs. So one morning when I woke up, I read a news item that dangerous Chhara gang is nabbed in Himmatnagar of Gujarat. I was not shocked to read that news, but I was ashamed of my fraternity because even today, after so much of, you know, telling people about the problems that these people face, you see such news items still coming in the, into the newspapers. I, because the newspaper, the editor of that newspaper was my friend, I dialed the editor, I called him, and I asked him as what was the need of this headline. This was the second time that I have dialed this editor, who is a very senior journalist and a renowned figure in Gujarat. He said that the reporters had followed the police press briefing, which says that Chhara gang has been arrested. At that moment, I realized that unless you have a Chhara reporter reporting about this incident, you cannot get rid of this problem. I had a detailed chat with that editor. He instructed his reporters to take care, but it was repeated again next time when a police briefing came. He said that, Roxy, we need to sensitize these reporters. I said, sir, diversity in newsroom and not the sensitization is the solution of this problem. So unless you have a diverse newsroom, I don't think such problems can be solved, wherein one community is constantly humiliated, be it Dalit, be it tribal, be it the denotified tribals. Now, there are few Dalits, tribals, and denotified tribals who had made it to the newsroom as journalists. There are few, very few. The percentage is negligible. However, it is also seen that they either avoid doing stories on their own caste and community or fails to convince the people at the leadership positions, means the chief reporters or the editors, for a story that brings a completely different narrative. It becomes very difficult. The point that I'm trying to make is that no people from the marginalized segments, there are very less or very negligible or no people from the marginalized segments are at the leadership position. Honestly, I am yet to meet any person from a marginalized segment at a leadership position in any media house, because of which some journalists from marginalized communities face this problem. Life for a reporter from a marginalized segment is really difficult in a newsroom. Even if he or she reaches to the newsroom, it's very difficult because they have to constantly sort of, you know, keep convincing about their news items and about their about what they want to do to their bosses. But at the same time, I should also tell you and emphasize on the fact that all organizations are not same. There are few organizations which are doing very well and which are actually creating a difference in this entire scenario where the diversity is lacking in the newsroom. Now, let me give you some examples of my reporting assignments as a representative of a marginalized tribe. I belong to the Chhara denotified tribe and I carry an experience of over 18 years as a journalist. Throughout my career, I had seen many major news happening starting from the Gujarat riots of 2002 to present day. I have worked with campus newspapers. I have worked with Gujarati newspaper. I have worked with business dailies. I have worked with the tabloid newspapers. I have worked with English dailies. And I am right now working with a very reputed group. I have been at the top of many major happenings in Gujarat and have covered almost all the elections since December 2002 in Gujarat. However, I am not going to bore you all with the stories of my reporting assignments, but I just want to share some observations of my reporting of the marginalized segments that I reported. You know, everyone is aware about the Statue of Unity in Kevadia of Gujarat. When Statue of Unity was inaugurated, at that time, a large number of reporters were reporting in Kevadia, where Prime Minister Narendra Modi was inaugurating the statue. And at that time, a large number of tribals were house arrested. They were not allowed to move out of their houses. No media was able to, you know, actually reaching to these tribal people and going to their houses to ask about them. So there are very few reporters from these marginalized communities who were able to, you know, understand their situation, and they were able to reach to them. And a balance, you know, at one side when majority of the media was busy reporting about what is happening at the Statue of Unity, a segment of media was reporting about what is happening with the tribals who were house arrested. I also reported about the problems that these tribals faced because of the Statue of Unity. For instance, Sardar Sarovar Dam stands there, but there are a large number of tribal farmers who are denied water in that area. We did a story on that, how tribal farmers are not given water in when their farms are right near the Sardar Sarovar Dam. I was also talking to some of the tribals over there, and they said that, you know, many tribal kids have started begging now. So entire culture of tribal culture was impacted because of Statue of Unity. So we did a story on, you know, how the culture of tribal is been affected because of the Statue of Unity, because of the commercialization of the entire tribal belt, because all the villages around Statue of Unity are dominated by Tadvi tribals, and now most of the kids of the Tadvi tribals have started begging because they can easily earn from that locality. So these are the stories which are there, but which never comes to come to people because of the lack of some sort of awareness or some sort of diversity into the newsroom. I also want to say that, you know, my reporting experience of Una. Recently, I had done a story on. I did a story on the family, the Dalit family of Una, who had to struggle for 8 years, and you know, so for getting their rights of, you know, they were forced to leave their house, and they were forced to leave their village, and they were not given another place to live. So they struggled for 8 years. So all these stories need to be told, need to be communicated to rest of the world. And unless we have diversity in newsroom, I don't think these people will get a proper space. Of course, these news items are reported when an uproar is being created. For example, when the Una victims were paraded on the public road, and when uproar was created, entire media reported about them. But after that, when that family was facing a lot of problems and they were struggling to get justice, eventually they eventually decided to leave Hinduism and embrace Buddhism. At that time, very less media representatives were there to report about their condition. So that things need to be told, that things need to be communicated, and those things can be communicated only when we have a variety of, you know, people in our newsrooms. I would also want to tell you something about my reporting assignments as a print journalist. When I reported about Dalit boycott, instances wherein Dalits were boycotted, and that created some impact. That things created some impact, and it has really helped those Dalits. One story done on such people, if the government notices that story, I think most of the activists which they cannot do, most of the agitations which they cannot do, I think one proper balanced story that highlights the exact problems with a balanced view from government and all other sides, I think that makes a lot of difference in the social justice, in the act of social justice. So I'm not saying that other people might not be doing this, but I'm saying that because people from the marginalized segments, if they are given an opportunity and they are allowed to reach to the newsroom and they are allowed to, you know, sort of tell their own stories, and if they are there at the leadership positions, I would say that many things can be told, which are so far not been told by the reporters. We do see reports on Dalits and tribals, but I would say that the empathy is lacking in those reports, and that empathy can only come if we have a balance of diversity in our newsroom. I would also want to say that journalists are actually not researchers. They are not scholars. Journalists are basically observers. And whatever they observe, eventually they report that. And their observation is connected to their background, their social background, their society, the place from where they come. So they observe some things, they connect it with their own background, and that's how they report. So most of the things that we see, as I mentioned earlier, if you don't have a balanced, diverse newsroom, if you have reporters only from some specific segments of the society, then I don't think that we'll be able to get a diverse news items in the newspapers or in the on the websites or on the TV that reaches to us. My observations, I would also want to share my observations about Dalits and tribal issues. Dalits, I have seen and observed that they are very active. They are very active in communicating with communicating about their problems, even though there are comparing between Dalits and tribals and the denotified tribals, I would say Dalits are very well placed when it comes to communicating their own problems, filing RTIs, getting information from the government, and getting to know about their rights, provisions for them and all. I think Dalits are very well placed. Of course, there is a lot to be done for their rights, but I'm comparing Dalits, tribals, and the denotified tribals. I've seen that there are many Dalits who are able to communicate about their problems with the reporters, and the reporters and most of the news stories that we see in the newspapers are actually happening only because the Dalits are very active. Many Dalits are educated, but it's not the case with the tribals. And tribals are I would say the communication is not very good. They are slightly disconnected from the mainstream society. So we definitely need many tribals to come up to the newsroom. And of course, the denotified tribals, the people who are from the ex-criminal tribes, very negligible people from the denotified tribals are representing the media, are representing themselves into the newsrooms. Also, I would want to, you might be aware about, that Dalits are, there are many websites, many channels, many new, the Dalits are using the new media very effectively, unlike tribals and the denotified tribals. The point that I'm trying to make is there is an option that has been explored by these marginalized communities to tell their stories, to tell their things to the rest of the world through this new media if they are not given a chance into the newsroom. But at the same time, I would say that unless we have the diverse newsroom, the problem of, the social justice is not going to solve. Before signing off, one last thing that I want to tell all of you is that next time when you go through any news item, just see that story of a newsroom behind the story. Who would have written it? What does it actually cover? How does it really voice the marginalized or the diversity is missing? Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Roxy. I think you've raised very important questions, and especially thank you for sharing your experience of covering these issues, especially with UNA and the Statue of Unity, because we tend to get very one-sided story of the whole tourism project, but we know that something else is happening, but they are not being covered so widely. So there are two things, I think, when you mentioned that often issues of news events related to Dalit and Adivasis are event-based. You go and capture the event, but there is no reflection of the real socio-economic conditions of there. So, and I like the way you said, you know, there is a lack of empathy. I think as even as scholars, as journalists, I think this is something we can keep, you know, keep in mind. And, you know, I think it's a very important takeaway point. And also, whenever there is a story by Dalit reporters or tribal reporters, the idea of token representation, not only in journalism field, but every field, and not to show diversity, to show open-mindedness, they'll say, okay, we'll take one, you know, Dalit representative. And so the notion to, that doesn't make the space diverse and democratic just because you have. So to make truly, making the space truly diverse and inclusive takes much more than that. To do justice to the story that you're covering. For today's talk, thank you so much, Roxy, for this wonderful talk. And thank you, everyone, for your comments and very wonderful, enriching discussion. Thank you so much. Bye-bye, everyone. Take care.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, everyone, for wonderful questions and hearing me out. Thank you very much.
Thank you.